Hey, 94.1. We're settling on a pose. We're done with the other poses.
Can you put your front arm forward more?
Yeah.
Okay. Actually, can you drop your head completely?
Like I've been vanquished? That usually happens later in the show.
All right, turn your head more toward me then. Now, is that going to be hard on your neck?
Nah, I don't think so.
It's just going to be a big arm study. But I suppose that's okay. Does it hurt your neck to turn like that?
I probably should.
All right. Turn more toward me.
Yeah. All right. That'll be all right.
Okay. All right. That's not bad.
All right. Let's do that.
Didn't we just do something like this, though?
Not really, no.
Well, let me just check the last one.
I mean, my arm was out like this in the last one, but everything else is different. All right, so what are
we going to talk about today?
We're going to start with what? You have more bullshit about the dossier.
All right, let's just get that over with real fast.
All right.
There has been a release of the testimony that Strzok and Page did in private to the, they gave this testimony in private to the,
House?
I believe it was the House, but it might have been the Senate.
It's probably the Senate because the Republicans are the ones who... Anyway, go ahead.
Well, what happened was a Republican just released their testimony. Mm-hmm. He just released it.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's... if he was allowed to, but he did it anyway. And so what it says is that the Justice Department, under Loretta Lynch... during the Obama administration, gave word to the FBI that they were not going to prosecute, they were not to prosecute Clinton for, what did she do? She...
what happened in a private service?
For her, yeah, but there was a... criminal negligence. So in other words, the release, allowing that information to be
what the available. Extra jeopardy of having a private server was negligent or something?
It was being negligent with government secrets. And I'll give you an example. If you were to go on to a nuclear base, a base that had anything nuclear, anything military, submarine, and you took a photograph and you put it on Facebook or you emailed it to your mom, you would go to jail. Now, if you had a private server in your basement where every single communique from the State Department to you and back and to the president was available to anybody that could hack into it, theoretically, you would be prosecuted for criminal negligence with U.S. intelligence secrets. There's a law.
We get it.
And you could spend the rest of your life in prison. So what happened was Loretta Lynch... told the FBI, look, we're just not going with this. Don't even bother. The exact wording, I'm not sure we have a transcript of an email, but those were her orders, according to Strzok and Page. I think specifically Page. So the reason this is significant is that it's the first time anybody has actually fingered. And don't make a joke. I know you're a comic.
Well, you already said release, so you know, okay. I'm not going to.
All right. This is the first time anybody's ever actually fingered the Obama administration. So now Loretta Lynch has been brought into it, and it basically means that the Obama administration was guilty of obstructing justice. If that's what they did, then that's obstruction of justice. That's absolutely, I don't know how else, what more obstruction of justice it could be. And so the significant thing for me is that since 2016, I've been waiting for the Obama administration to be brought in. Like we've gotten up to Comey, we got up to various members of the Justice Department, we got up to the FBI. This is the first time we've actually made it up to the Attorney General.
All right, so bring her in. Just fucking ask her what her rationale was, if she said that. I mean, because there can be reasonable arguments and there can be obstruction of justice arguments. As a good liberal, I'll argue that if you're going to prosecute Hillary Clinton, then you have to prosecute the last three or four secretaries of state because they all use private servers. A second argument is, you know, how secure was the private server? Because, you know, I've been told by my liberal media that it was no less secure or no more subject to hacking than the government servers.
Well,
no more vulnerable to hacking, say.
Right. Well, it's specifically stated in the bylaws of the State Department, and it was a circular given by Hillary to everyone in the State Department that they were not to transmit emails on anything but a government server. So apparently she thought it was significant enough to enforce that law. So the intelligence that I heard was that they now believe at least five enemy nations were able to hack into that server.
Who's they? Who's saying that five?
I don't remember the name of the intelligence agency, but whoever was the government investigator that was charged with determining what happened with this computer said that it was almost certainly hacked into. So there go all of America's highest secrets, because the Secretary of State knows everything. The only person that may know more is the President. So for the Justice Department to issue an order to the FBI saying, look, do not do anything that would indicate that she was criminally negligent in your report, that means that the Obama administration was guilty of obstruction of justice.
Well, you don't know until you do more investigating.
The person that was charged with investigating it was Strzok. Strzok was in charge of that investigation, and that's what he said happened.
Yeah, but you don't know for sure until you, I don't know if you ever know for sure, but if you want to haul Loretta Lynch in.
Well, they're going to have to.
Okay. All right, fine.
All right.
All right, next thing. So 50 people, 50 Muslims at a mosque. Was it just one mosque or was it a couple?
They say it was two, but I don't know how he got from one to the other without being captured.
Somebody grabbed his gun away from him at one of, but anyway, New Zealand, a white supremacist type, shot about 100 people, 50 of them died, issued a 74-page manifesto citing people, including like Candace Owens, who's a conservative commentator in the U.S. So this made me wonder, you know, could we be guilty of encouraging some fucking asshole? Not that we have as many listeners or viewers as Candace Owens, who probably has a couple hundred thousand followers. But could we be guilty of encouraging somebody to shoot up a place? Because you, for instance, don't have good things to say about Islam.
So this is the show where you accuse me of murder.
No, but I'm wondering, like, fucking, can we be complicit in some crazy asshole, like, picking and choosing shit from the, you know, the vast orchard of the internet to support his deranged point of view? Could we be contributing to that shit?
Well, I have to unpack, because there's a variety of little time bombs in what you said. The first is that you know who this guy was and why, what his motive was.
Well, just from coverage, that he issued a 74-page manifesto,
right,
that had a lot in common with the, was it the guy in Denmark?
Do you want to keep your head up?
Okay.
Norway,
who shot 70, I don't know, a shitload of people. No, I didn't read the manifesto.
Well, no. The reason that's significant is because I looked all day trying to find the manifesto. Not because I wanted to help this guy, but I wanted, in the loosest possible sense, I'm now a kind of a journalist. And so I wanted to actually read the manifesto so I could speak about it reasonably. The first problem is that the manifesto could be anything. It may not be credible. It may be stuff that he's deliberately lying about, because he's obviously not a fair and impartial guy that you could rely upon. He's a mass murderer.
Yeah.
So we don't know whether his manifesto is truthful and sincere.
Right, but we do know that he shot 100 Muslims.
We do, but we also can't find the manifesto. I challenge anybody watching this right now to find the manifesto. I couldn't.
Well, it may be. The deal is that he posted the slaughter.
Keep your head just like that.
He posted the slaughter live online as he was killing. And right. There's been a push since then to make sure that you can't find it easily. Because one of the things these guys do is
they want the publicity. They want people to understand their views.
Well, they just want to be fucking famous. Like, right. I don't know the guy's name.
Right.
And I haven't seen his slaughter video. And maybe right. His manifesto is part of the same deal. We're just not going to give the guy, you know, reward him for killing all those people.
Well, that's of course what all the news media are saying. I mean, it's like, you know, if you, as you say, if you the ticket to having your manifesto read shouldn't be if you murder someone, it's automatic and you get more publicity than William Shakespeare. That's fine. But the problem is that nobody really knows what this guy said. Unless you've actually read the manifesto, you don't really know.
Well, you kind of get an idea based on reporting on it.
Right, but the problem is that the leftists are all reporting that he did this for Trump. His goal was to help Trump, because Trump's a racist, and he's a racist, and so they get along perfectly, and this was a love letter to Trump.
Well, I haven't heard that.
And then when I listened to Fox News, they're saying that he was a follower of Red China, of Communist China, and that he actually doesn't particularly care for Trump. He just mentions Trump in the manifesto.
Yeah, well, oh, right.
So like, all day long, I've been having liberals on Facebook write to me, aha! So you see, your guy Trump is causing Muslims to be murdered because he's a white nationalist and this guy was a white nationalist, so Trump got all the Muslims killed, and you're part of it too, Lance. And I'm saying, wait a minute, a crazy guy in New Zealand murders people, Muslims, and automatically I'm supposed to vote for Clinton? It doesn't make any sense.
Well, you can't, because you can't go back to 2016 anyway.
I hate it when you do that.
All right, it's done. Oh, all right.
So, I mean, my point is that I had to explain all day to my credulous liberal friends on Facebook that no, Trump did not order this to happen. Trump is not responsible for this happening. My explanation is this. There is a mass migration from the third world and the southern hemisphere into the westernized countries. The reason is that the westernized countries are more advanced and successful, and people want to get the hell out of the other portions of the world. So what they're doing is they're going to the westernized countries and they're causing unrest with the people that live there.
Oh yeah, I guess I'm not. Go ahead, sorry.
So my point is that inevitably there will be crazy people that won't want migrants coming into their country. Some people will say, well, we don't need more migrants, and therefore we're going to use the laws of our country and the ballot box to slow down immigration. But there will also be kooks who will think that they have to become violent. And it isn't Trump's fault, because it's a worldwide phenomenon. This migration from the Middle East and from the Southern Hemisphere is going on all over the world in almost every advanced country. So it isn't Trump's fault, and it's not my personal fault, because I criticized the prophet, because I'm guilty of blasphemy in your eyes, Rick.
No, I'm not saying you're guilty of blasphemy, but you know, you've called Islam a death cult, and
which it is. And by the way, I've been waiting since 9/11 for this to happen. I mean, there's only so many Muslim terrorist acts that you can perform before some crazy person that is ostensibly Christian, that is somebody born from a Christian culture, is going to think they have to do terrorist actions back. I mean, I'm surprised it took till now. I'm surprised it's not happening in every country in Europe and North America. After being poked and pricked by terrorists, by Muslim terrorists.
It's almost like you're supporting this guy.
Well, no, but the thing is, I'm not, because I think that Muslim immigration should be cut back using the ballot box. But it amazes me that it took 18 years for there to be an attack on a mosque of this scale after Muslims have done thousands of attacks in the Western world. And I'm not running for president. I know that if CNN was listening to this, they could twist it and say that I'm, just as you did, that I support bombing mosques. I'm just saying, with all the crazy people in the advanced countries, in the westernized countries, it's amazing that this is the first time something like this has happened.
That's not a terrible point, but somebody was on the news today. They keep track of, you know, they said in the past year, 78% of the hate crimes, the race-based crimes in America have come from the right.
Yeah, I keep hearing that, and I'm sorry. I know it's a big deal to you guys, but one, I don't believe it. Two, I'd like to see all the statistics. And three, I have found that places like the Southern Poverty Law Center will actually lie about this. Like, it's very important for your side to somehow prove that the real problem in America is Christians. And I don't buy it.
Well,
I know you believe that you've got incontrovertible proof, but I don't believe it.
I'll give you this statistic.
Okay.
New Zealand and America both have populations that are 1.1% Muslim.
Okay.
But the population of conservative white people is in the tens of millions, if not 100 million. So just in terms of the demographics of getting up to horrible mischief would tend to suggest that, yeah, there's way more of Whitey than there is of Omar.
Does this impact Brexit and what's going on in France, the Yellow Jackets as well, would you say?
Oh, I don't know, but I did want to bring up, I forgot. My kid is going to grad school in London, so I'm going to take the no-go zone challenge.
Ooh.
I'm good. So she's going to London, and when I visit, I will figure out where the supposed no-go zones are, and I'll frickin' go there.
What's important is I can show you videos. It was a little hard. I'm a little embarrassed because last week I couldn't find the right videos.
Mm-hmm.
There are videos of camera crews going into these no-go zones and getting beaten up. So you have to actually, you can't, like, for example, right now you look like Cat Stevens. So
You know what? I'll go into the fucking no-go zones with a Star of David.
Okay. That's what I'm saying.
On a necklace or something.
If you can't wear if you have a camera crew with you, or if you have a camera, you're filming, or if you wear a Star of David, that's good, a real big one.
I mean, I don't think I could look any more Jewish. I look like a freaking Hebrew guy.
No, but you also, I believe I could walk through a no-go zone without being accosted. The question is if you go through the no-go zone and you have...
Well, then it's not really a no-go zone if you can walk through there.
Well, no, but the point is that you could be bringing in fish or something. They're not going to bother you. What you have to be doing is actually showing that you're not Muslim and that you may be indifferent to Sharia. In other words, there are films of camera crews going in. There are police. The German leader Merkel admitted that there are areas of Germany where the police don't go in anymore.
I don't know. I'll find out. I'm going to London.
Okay. When are you leaving?
Well, I don't know, because probably not for a year. It's a delightful fucking city. All right. What do you want to talk about now? Let's talk about the admissions scam.
Just really quick.
Okay.
Did you want to say anything about what's going on in France with the Yellow Jackets and Brexit or Brexit?
Well, the a lot of people are thinking that right wingers are kind of hoping that the reason that there are riots in France are because of the Muslims taking over France, which is basically what they're doing. But
hoping that it's the Muslims?
Yeah, I mean, I was hoping that the French would stand up for themselves. But I frankly am not, even as much as I can't believe what I hope. I have to go with my brain. And my brain is telling me that the French are the highest taxed people in Europe. No, they're the highest taxed people in the world. And
how much are they getting taxed?
I don't know. But if you go to a chart of the highest taxed people, the French are at the top. And so as a result, I don't believe they're rioting to fight back against Muslim immigration. I think they're rioting because they are broke, which, by the way, the French have always cared about money a lot as a people. They pretend they don't, but they do. And they have found themselves to be among the... Their standard of living is very poor because, number one, they're ludicrously highly taxed, and number two, their work hours are very short. So among the people in the world, they work among the fewest hours.
Yeah, they get huge vacations.
Yeah.
And stuff.
So unfortunately, because of that combination of the taxes and the low workload, they're not making enough money to get by. And I looked at it, and their standard of living is terrible compared to an American.
Also, but they know how to, they can get by. They can make meals out of snails.
Are they pro-Trump?
Well, it turns out that there are people saying, I don't know, I haven't been there, but people say this is not a left-right thing. It's actually the left and the right. That if you go and you talk to the Yellow Jackets, they're fairly eclectic. A lot, there are right wingers, left wingers. People are basically dissatisfied with the lot of the average person. Now, frankly, if they are dissatisfied, they've got to be dissatisfied with socialism, because in other words. So even if the left wing are part of the rebellion, they're rebelling against socialism because France is a socialist, to a large extent, a socialist country, has a lot of socialism as its policies. So another failure for left wing policies.
Did a lot
right?
of actors move there at one point?
No, actually actors were moving out. There's a famous case of Gerard Depardieu.
Yeah, they're moving out because he might fall on you. He weighs about 300 pounds.
Right. Well, he actually left France because the taxes were so high. So that's what happens when you have socialism. And it may be that there is a reaction against Muslim immigration.
It doesn't seem like part of it. But,
the problem with France is it's now 10% Muslim. So my concern is that they're going to get a hold of France's nuclear arsenal.
All right. I don't know enough. Let's move on to Brexit. So my point of view of Brexit is I can understand why people wouldn't want to be under the thumb of the EU, but... My understanding is there are economies of scale that you get from belonging to the EU, and that I don't know a lot, but I know that that they're having a lot of trouble getting anybody to agree to a Brexit deal in England. And
didn't they have a vote already?
They did, but it was close and. At least according to what I've heard, that the pro-Brexit people said a lot of bullshit. And that I would think they would want to have another referendum. The referendum they had was non-binding, but they're still going along with it. And the risk is that they leave the EU without a deal, which I guess leaves them subject to more terrible terms. But part of the problem is that probably most of the people in England don't want to leave.
You know, what amazes me is how complete the brainwashing is. How on every subject, your news sources have managed to confuse you, or lie to you, or misinform you. It's astounding, because in every case, the subject is brought up, and you repeat, obviously, what you've heard on a liberal news source, and it's almost as if it was written for you to parrot by somebody that was extremely left-wing. Now, I'm not even criticizing you personally. I'm saying it astonishes me how they managed to give you all of this information as if you were speaking right from their mouths. In fact, they even managed to lie to you. And because you don't have any other news source, you believe it and repeat it as if it's true.
So you're saying the people, the pro-Brexit people, were telling the truth when they said they were going to...
Don't tell me what I'm saying. I'm going to tell you what I'm saying.
All right, go then, do it.
To me, there's two things significant about the story. The first is how well you're parroting what they want you to think. And two, how it's wrong. First of all, they had a vote, a Brexit vote.
Was it binding?
Could you just let me talk?
Go ahead.
In a rare occasion, the British don't usually do referendums by vote. But they finally said, all right, we'll let the people vote. And the people voted a narrow victory for leaving the EU. For those that don't know, Britain is stuck in the EU, along with a lot of other European countries, and there are a variety of terrible things about that for Britain. And so the British people got fed up, and their politicians wouldn't let them out, even though they kept saying, we want to get out of this thing. I'll just give you an example, just so you'll know. What Brexit is allowing is thousands and thousands of people from Eastern Europe to come in and take all the low-skilled jobs in Britain. And for example, they're getting huge numbers of Poles. Now, people from Poland, they also have pretty much unrestricted migration from, Muslim countries. Because the EU is allowing in millions of Muslims. So,
got a question. Couldn't Britain restrict immigration without leaving the EU?
No. Once you're in the EU, you have to abide by all of their directives. And the one of the directives is completely free migration. So as a result, there are three times more immigrants from the European countries in Britain than there are British people in Europe. And the British don't like it because what it means is the people from the countries where they're not doing as well economically are going to Britain and soaking up all the wealth. They're going on welfare. They are taking low-skilled jobs, which is what would happen whenever you have migration from a poor country to a rich country. So that's not the only problem. The second problem is that the British are finding that they're losing sovereignty over their own country. So what's happening is unelected bureaucrats in Belgium, which is the seat of the European Union, are telling the British how to do. They're micromanaging things that are happening in Britain.
Like farming and stuff.
Yeah, like products, like... things like that. There are all kinds of trade deals, this and that. So the British said, you know what, we're fed up with this. We're our own country. We beat the Nazis. We beat the Napoleon. We don't have to put up with this. And so they tried to get free of Britain, but the part of the EU... the European Union, but the British politicians wouldn't go along with it. First, the Labour politicians wouldn't go along with it because they're globalists, they're socialists. They want a worldwide socialist government. They loved it. The Conservatives wouldn't go along with it either. Nobody knows why. Somebody knows, but I don't know why. So finally, the British people put up such a fuss that they said, look, we want out. And if neither the Conservatives nor the leftists are going to get us out, we want a referendum.
Well, I got a question. it was a Labour guy, a Labour prime minister, right, who said go ahead with the referendum, thinking that it wouldn't pass. Wasn't that the deal? And then it backfired on him?
No, it was a conservative politician. It was a conservative prime minister.
But wasn't that the idea, though?
Okay. The conservative prime minister was against leaving Britain, leaving the EU. Camille, wake up. Oh, I thought your eyes were closed. If our own people are falling asleep, I'll have to apologize to our viewers, our 100 viewers.
200. Sometimes 300.
All right. So what happened was the conservative prime minister of Britain, there was no strategy. He simply allowed the referendum to go ahead. And they used the BBC. They used every possible arm of government that they could to talk the British people out of it. But a grassroots movement was able to scrape together enough votes to win a slim majority and pass Brexit. So what that means is they have to pull out.
Well, it doesn't mean that because it's not a binding resolution.
Well, even if it isn't binding, it is a democratic vote. And unfortunately, in the Western world, Rick, I know you want a socialist paradise where the government tells you what to do.
No, they should have another frickin' referendum.
No. You can't keep having referendums until you get your way.
Sure you can. I mean, Scotland has had, I think, it's like, you know, they keep rebooting Spider-Man. If you can do three Spider-Men in 12 years, you can have a second referendum 2 years later after everybody's kind of seen the mess that trying to do Brexit has
made. No, there is no mess. It's just the British government doesn't want to do what their people say.
Well, but part of the mess is that...
Why are you arguing with me?
I don't know, but I'm just going to... Well, because you're saying I'm brainwashed and I only believe what I've been told.
You've been told that they lost the vote, and the truth is that... No.
They won the fucking vote.
You just said a minute ago that they lost, but it turns out that they won.
What do you mean they won?
Your news source told you that the British people are against Brexit, and that's not true. The British people are in favor of leaving.
You have another referendum now.
No, wait a minute. You can't just keep having referendums until you win, Rick. That's what the British people are saying. Look, this is a democracy. We voted to leave that union. You can't have another referendum. You leave the union.
I think you can. You're not the boss of referendums.
No, but
they're not going to help.
The people are the boss of Britain. Okay? The people voted to leave. Now you have to go with the will of the people, Rick. In the Western world, maybe not in communist Korea.
Well, Rick wants to go to the abolish electoral college, right?
No, I'm just saying that there's a movement, but we'll get to that. What I have found out, at least from Twitter, where I get all my frickin' news, is that politicians on both sides, the Tories and the Conservatives, are both stupid. That Theresa May seems to be not so competent, and
tilt your head back.
Okay, and the people on the other side, Labour, are also. This is not a good time for British politicians. It's not a good time for American politicians either, but...
Well, that's really irrelevant. The point is that the British people voted to leave that union, and they are to leave it, and they are to leave it within a few weeks. And when they do, they will be a sovereign nation just like every other nation, and they'll get by just the way every other nation does. There will be no repercussions. If some country wants to punish Britain economically, then they will suffer a trade war with Britain. They're free to do that. But the only repercussion is Britain becomes a sovereign country making its own decisions without the interference of bureaucrats in Belgium.
Yeah, and all the trade with the EU, which is their major trading partner, becomes... Yeah.
Well, if the EU wishes to punish them, they can do that. But
if they can't come up with a deal, which is part of the problem.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is you don't make a deal, you leave. And what would happen is the deal would be subject to international law, the World Trade Organization. In other words, the overseer of fairness in the world of trade is the World Trade Organization, which is on a higher level than the European Union.
Where is it based?
I don't know.
Well, Europe.
Well, the point is that it's not a governing body. It's simply a body that determines what's fair in international trade deals.
Does it have any power? No.
It doesn't have enforcement power, but the point is that Britain would just be like any other country. It would be like if Argentina wanted to deal with France. It would have to obey the guidelines of what is considered fair by the World Trade Organization. So the point is that Britain has nothing to lose. They could try to have an amicable deal with the European Union by allowing European immigration to Britain. They could do that as a gesture of goodwill, but it doesn't really make any difference. Britain's a sovereign country. They can just leave.
I gotta say that Putin loves Brexit. Anyway, let's go on to the admissions scandal. See if we got anything to say about that.
You start.
All right. I got one thing. A bunch of rich. I guess they're not really dipshits. They're just they're cheaters.
Okay.
You know, pulled all sorts of strings, bribes. Hiring people to take the SATs, you know, you've read this, everybody knows, to get their kids into elite colleges. And the only thing I have to say, well, I've got others, I can offer you stuff, but the only opinion really I have is that no, obviously you don't want to let cheaters in, but beyond cheaters, there are issues of fairness revolving around admission to elite colleges, in that there are many tens of thousands of kids who have great qualifications and who could do a great job going to these schools. Many more kids, you know, say 50,000 kids could excel at an Ivy League school, but like the class at Harvard and Yale, Harvard and Yale only admit like 1,600-1,700 kids a year. So somebody's gonna get screwed over. Asians are suing, saying they're getting screwed over because if you let Asians in on the basis of unbiased admissions, Asians would be 40% or more of the student bodies of these places. Because Asians kick ass. Asians are the Jews of the 21st century. What Jews were, you know, 100 years ago when the Ivies tried to limit the number of Jews getting in because there were too many qualified Jews, Asians are now. So Asians are getting screwed over. But you can also argue that black people get screwed over because they come demographically, black people and brown people come from disadvantaged backgrounds. Anyway, it's a big mess, and one thing they could do, which they won't, is make more spaces for kids. All the Ivies, except for maybe Cornell, which already is pretty slutty and lets in like 3,000 kids a year compared to more than any other Ivy. But the Ivies could pledge to, you know, raise the size of their classes by 5% a year for the next 5 years. So the Ivies are letting in, you know, 2,000 students a year instead of 1,600, which is a ridiculously small number for schools that are this rich. You know, every one of these, the Ivies has endowments, savings, investments, totaling many billions of dollars. They could afford to open up the classes more, let in more people, which means that many more people aren't getting screwed over. That's all I got on that.
I agree with you. I also think that the reason college is so expensive is because the government is giving all these crazy loans, and so the only thing the colleges do is just raise their prices, knowing that the government will give student loans. If the government stopped doing that, there would be more of a price war. Capitalism would take over, and the price of the colleges would go down.
Well, those loans are no picnic.
Well, yeah, you got to pay them back. But my response to the scandal itself is, it really shocked me when I found out that they had raided some actress's home and at gunpoint dragged her off to jail. And
Felicity Huffman?
I don't know who it was. A blonde woman.
Yeah, Felicity Huffman.
And I remember thinking, well, okay, I'm as appalled by this as anybody, but I didn't know that we were that strict about bribing college coaches. You know, I mean, it seems odd to me that, for example, when you worked on the Jimmy Kimmel show, mm-hmm. if I had bribed you to somehow get me a spot on the Jimmy Kimmel show, would the government send people with guns and drag me off to jail?
No, because you would have bribed me with, I don't know, a painting or something. But no, you wouldn't have bribed me. This was a $25 million enterprise.
Right.
The guy who ran the thing had funneled $25 million through his business, through the illicit arm of his business. I think people spent up to $6.5 million cheating.
Well, I understand that it was large. I'm just saying, do you think it's right that this woman gets dragged off to jail for bribing a college coach?
Yeah, I mean,
at gunpoint.
Well, the deal when the FBI raids a place, it's, you know, everybody's got all their records online now, or on computers, on electronic devices. So I believe the reason you raid a place at 4:30 in the morning, and yeah, FBI agents carry guns, is to not tip off the person so they aren't able to delete all their emails.
Well, so why don't just take the computer and say, thank you very much, we'll see you in court in 2 weeks.
I don't know. I mean, but when they raid a place, they raid a place they have to.
I understand you want that element that keeps you from destroying records, but I just think it's an overreaction. I mean, the guy that did it was a major fraudster, and I could see him going to jail because there were millions of dollars involved. But some parent thinking that, okay, this is how you get your kid into college, I'll bribe someone. I mean, it's rotten, it's dirty. But I just don't see, you know, taking her off to jail at gunpoint. It just seems extreme to me. I mean, I don't know what the law is, but it doesn't seem right.
No.
Well, I mean, that's how you got your kid into college, isn't it? By bribing somebody?
No, my kid hired me to teach her how to take the SATs, and I made her take, before she fired me, I made her take 80 practice tests over a period of like a year.
Wow. Do you think that the practice has helped, or something that she learned in the process, in just being a good student? Because I know she was a great student.
There are two tests that people take, the SAT or the ACT. SAT is supposed to measure basic skills. As to whether it does that or not is highly debatable. The ACT actually measures what you've learned. At the time my kid was taking the SAT, the SAT is what you took. Now it seems that at a lot of places people have shifted over to the ACT. So it's not what she learned in school. The SAT is kind of a more specialized set of skills. That's the way you kick ass on the SAT. This is, you don't pay tutors $5,000. You don't take courses, you don't cheat. What you do is, starting 18 months before you have to take the SAT for real, you start taking practice tests. One or two 20, 30 minute practice, you know, subtests every weekend for about 80 weeks. You'll get through a few dozen practice SATs. You will have seen just about every type of SAT question that they can ask. Oh, also you have to go over every time you take a practice test, you have to look at the problems you got wrong, and you have to understand why you got it wrong and how to do that type of problem right. And if you do that, you will kick ass on the SAT, but it takes two or three dozen practice tests.
Now, how do you learn what you did wrong? How do you improve what you did wrong?
That's where you spend money on a tutor. You don't spend money on a tutor to babysit you for hour after hour. You take some practice tests, and then you pay for a tutor if you want one to come in for an hour after you've got, you know, four or five subtests under your belt, and you've got a couple dozen problems to go over, and you go over them with the tutor, and he or she works with you and gets you so you understand, you know, how to spot, you know, right triangles, how to use the Pythagorean theorem if that's your problem. If it's a swimming pool problem, like, you know, water is flowing into the swimming pool at 5 gallons a minute, but it's leaking out of the bottom at 2.5 gallons a minute, how long is it going to take, you know? If it's a problem like, there are all these kind of specialized SAT type problems, and a tutor can walk you through those. Or the book, they have plenty of books that contain the answers plus the explanations for the answers, so you can do it yourself. That's how you do it.
Could somebody invent, or do you think it already exists, like on a contact or some glasses, you can wear it to one of these tests, and, like somebody else is watching it?
Yeah, you could do that kind. I mean, there was one scam that happened, I don't know, like 8 years ago, where people went in with specially marked pencils. There was a series of notches on the pencil, and you would read the notches, and that would tell you, you know, how to answer fill in the dots. I mean, the way to do it, and don't do this, is... I mean, there was even a movie with Scarlett Johansson, I think, called The Perfect Score from like 5 years ago, or more. No, it has to be longer than that, 12 years ago, where she's a high school student, she and her friends break into the SAT headquarters to steal a test. So it was all in good fun back then, but when it really happens, then people are not so happy. But, I mean, one way to do it would be...
I just want to say that The Perfect Score was actually... the guy that took Scarlett Johansson to the prom.
Sweet, yeah. I don't know if she even went. Yeah. True. All right, so what you want to do is fly to Hawaii to take the test. And so I think Hawaii is either 5 or 6 hours later by time zone than New York. Then you have somebody in New York who takes the test, who, you know, maybe takes pictures of the, you know, using a spy camera and takes pictures of the test, works out the answers, and then emails you the answers. So you can walk into the test in Hawaii a couple hours later with the answer. People have probably done that.
So,
but don't do that. You're an asshole if you do that.
So what do you think of basically should happen to these people?
It depends, like, if you're reading the articles, some of the kids were in on it, some of the kids were not. All of a sudden, they just got this excellent score. They took the test, you know, and they fucked it up, probably. But their parents hired somebody to, in some cases, the parents hired a special proctor to, after the kid got done with the test, to go through and correct the test before turning it into... to ETS, the test company.
How could you do that without anybody noticing?
Because here's another thing to do if you want to do well on these tests. You can apply for special testing circumstances if you have test anxiety, if you have dyslexia, if you have bad eyesight. There are a number of conditions that you can go see a psychologist to have diagnosed, and then you, based on these conditions, if the psychologist believes that you have them, you can apply to the SAT and the ACT people to have extra time on the test, to have somebody read you the questions if you have a reading difficulty. to only have to take one section a day. There are about 8 different ways that you can have relaxed conditions to take the test. And so a lot of these kids may have been tested in one-on-one conditions with just their own individual proctor. And if that proctor was dirty, then the proctor could correct the kid's test and the kid wouldn't even know. So,
and if your parents work for a living, like minimum wage job, they can't afford the college.
No, because of probably, you know, getting diagnosed is going to be at least $500 and it's probably going to be at least $1,000. You know, because there's the meeting with the psychologist, there's the psychologist writing the letter. I assume it's, you know.
Okay.
So, all right, can we break?
Sure.
All right.